Hello, I'm Tom Hollingsworth, and welcome to Networking Field Day. We are here, the offices of Ixia, with a group of invited writers, speakers, podcasters, and other luminaries in the networking community. They are here to ask questions, make comments, and enhance the discussion about Ixia's solutions and products. If you would like to learn more about Tech Field Day, including how to become one of these delegates or a presenter, please visit our website at techfieldday.com. If you would like to see more videos like this, involving great technical content, please check out our YouTube channel at youtube.com/techfieldday.
As you can see, Ixia has a significant presence in test as well as visibility. So my name is Recep Ozdag. I'm the Vice President of Product Management within Ixia's NVS Network Visibility Solutions Division. What I really want to do is spend 10 or 15 minutes background in terms of explaining how Ixia comes into the play in terms providing visibility and security. Right. As Marie mentioned, security is very challenging. It's very difficult. Enterprises are at risk of exposure all the time. Hacks are happening all the time. And partially because there's new threats, new applications, new compliance requirements. Right. We all always hear about the big hacks, such as the one that happened with Target, with Home Depot. I had to change my credit card with Home Depot. I did not know that I had a credit card with Home Depot. Right. Most recently, Yahoo. Right. As Yahoo was trying to sell itself to Verizon, it lost $1 billion in valuation just because as a result of a hack. Right. So that's business impact right there and then. And that's just the tip of the iceberg. Right. There are many more hacks that are happening that are not necessarily covered by the news, but they're there. Now, our lives are not getting any easier because there are a number of trends happening in the industry that are making it even more difficult to provide security. With bring your own devices, there are more uncontrolled devices that are connecting to the network. So how do you provide security? With encryption, it's great for us, right? Privacy, our messages are encrypted, but so are the messages and the malicious code coming from hackers. Again, with IoT, there are more uncontrolled devices connecting the network. How do you know which one is compromised? How do you provide security? And of course, the last one is cloud. Now, great, especially with public cloud. I'm running my applications on the cloud. I'm putting my data on the cloud. Does this mean that I don't have to worry about application performance monitoring or security? Because you know I'm paying Amazon, so I don't have to worry about anything. I can just wipe my hands clean. Amazon is responsible for everything. Well, that's not true. Chris is going to spend more time on that. We have some great initiatives there. But it's even more challenging in the public cloud, because now you don't have access to the infrastructure, so you can't really just connect your tools, right? And that's why it really requires a different way of thinking, because we didn't really come up with electricity by just continuing to improve candles, right? And so we're doing really some groundbreaking stuff, very excited about that. Whether you have a simple network or a complicated network, there are blind spots everywhere. And it's not really a question of if, it's a question of when these blind spots will lead into big problems or business disruption. The goal with visibility is to eliminate essentially these blind spots. It's to ensure application performance, network security, data security in this complex environment that affects businesses and help them make intelligent decisions to secure their business assets. Okay. And because of that, there's a whole portfolio of security devices, right? For security, application performance, analytics, cloud, many devices from many vendors, a very big industry. How do you connect these devices to a network? Do you just have an ad hoc approach, willy-nilly start introducing these devices? Do you just look at server log files? Do you want to look at live data? Do you want to see a hack happening, or do you want to prevent a hack from happening? Right. How do you insert these tools? How many tools do you insert live into the network? Let's assume you introduce five tools for intrusion detection and intrusion prevention. By the way, the average enterprise uses about 30 tools. Yeah, 30, according to statistics. I didn't count, but I rely on the reports that come out from the analysts. Now, this is not just for security, though. It includes application performance monitoring, et cetera. How do you introduce these tools? How do you upgrade the software, given that these are now in line between inside the network? How do you upgrade the hardware? Do you bring the network down? What if one of these tools fail? What happens to the network, given that it's in line? How, what about SSL decryption? Can all your tools do SSL decryption? Do you just throw away the ones that cannot and buy brand new ones? Is that financially viable? If you have 10 gig links, how do you connect it to your old tools that have 1 gig links? Again, do you throw them up, throw them away, buy new ones? Or do you buy 10 of them and do load balancing? And if you do load balancing, are you doing session-aware load balancing so all the sessions go to the same box? So it's very challenging to have this ad hoc method. And that's where Axia's multi-vendor network visibility and security platforms comes into play. We essentially provide a formal structured platform to connect all these tools to the network. And we provide crucial and real-time information pertaining to application performance, data security, networking security, and correlate all that information, not just at the packet layer, but all the way up to the application layer, and turn it into intelligent and actionable insight that businesses can use to secure the networks. So customers use this in two ways. One is to get insight or improve the insight that they get from their out-of-band monitoring tools and security tools, or ensure fail-safe deployment of their inline security tools. And it really starts with accessing data, because you cannot secure what you cannot see. It's as simple as that. And to see data, you need to be able to access it. And this is where taps come into play. As we mentioned, a tap is a very simple device. Between point A and point B, you can introduce this device, and it will not disrupt the communication at all. It will make an identical copy, including error messages, in real time. You won't miss any packets at all. There's copper taps, fiber taps, secure plus taps. And of course, as we go to virtualization, there's more VM-to-VM communication happening on the servers that even don't go to the network. So you can't really use physical taps, and that's why we have virtual taps. Virtual taps for VMware, OpenStack, Bare Metal, and Amazon. And we're really, really excited about the Amazon one because it's a bit different. We don't have access to the infrastructure, so we have to use Amazon services, because we'll talk about that a bit more. There's also the concept of a bypass switch, very similar to a tap, but instead of copying the data, you still insert it between points A and B, and it will divert that traffic into a network of security devices. Right. So A and B will still think that they're directly communicating with each other, whereas in reality, it's going through a security fabric. And you can decide if a catastrophe happens, what you want to do. If you want any of the security tools fail, you can decide to bypass that tool, or you can decide to shut down the network or just that connection. Right? Depends. And we'll spend more time on the bypass switches. But now that we've collected this vast amount of data, because we want to tap everywhere, that's the mantra, taps everywhere, tap everything. You simply cannot really just send all those all that data to the tools, because now you have too many data, vast amounts of data, and it's just not financially viable to spend on these tools, security tools, application monitors, extremely expensive. So this is where we introduce the concept of a network packet broker. It can be a physical device or a virtual device. This is where we start to apply intelligent filtering to send the right information to the right tool. It looks like a switch. It's not a switch. A switch has to follow certain forwarding rules, right? When you introduce a switch into a network, it has the control plane there. It has to communicate with the rest of the network. It has to start learning packets, and it has to essentially work harmoniously with the rest of the network. So it has to follow certain rules. Yes, there are certain filtering capabilities, but it's very limited. A network packet broker, on the other hand, we have full control over exactly where packets go. Absolutely full control over the registers of the TCAM tables, and it's not a switch. If you just insert it into a network, it's not going to act like a switch. And we're going to do a demo. We're going to spend significant time on that, but I want to make that clear. Now, here we can do advanced filtering, layer 2 to layer 4, decide which packets should go to which tools. Right? You know, not all tools see to all the packets. You know, layer 2 to layer 4, so DMAC, SMAC, IP addresses, port, VLAN, etc. We have full control over there. Now, Maria showed this image as we introduce taps there to collect the data. These can be virtual taps too. In a virtual tap, we will create a GRE tunnel and send that to a fabric of network packet brokers. And from there, we can apply intelligent filtering and send the right information to the right tool at the right bandwidth. And we're going to do a live demo of that step by step. We can also bring all that fabric inline. So I'm bringing all that fabric inline. I'm using bypass switches. In this particular case, point A and point B think that they're communicating directly, whereas it's really going through all those tools. And that fabric of bypass switches and network packet brokers can detect if any of those tools fail. And if it does, then you can decide preemptively what to do. Maybe you just want to bypass that tool. Maybe you want to bypass the whole security fabric. Or maybe you don't want any traffic to go in your network, because if it doesn't go through an intrusion prevention system, maybe you feel like that is not investigated packets, right? You didn't look into them, and you don't want them entering your network or leaving your network. We'll spend some more time there. The next step is really context-aware data processing. Now that we've tapped everything, it's possible that we have generated multiple copies of the same frame. Technically, the MAC addresses might be changing, but the context of the frame is the same. So if I have generated 10 exact copies, as you can imagine, if a packet is going from one part of the network to another and it's going through switch by switch, if I'm tapping that data, it's possible that I can generate up to, just as an example, 10 copies of that frame. I don't really want to send that to my tools. What I can do is essentially intelligent deduplication. So I can detect all that traffic, find the unique one, and only send that to my security tools. So that the ROI is right there immediately. If my tools don't have SSL decryption capability, I can normalize it for all my tools and apply SSL decryption. In some industries, such as banks and hospitals, you're not supposed to actually look at confidential data, credit card, patient history, et cetera. So we can data mask that information before you send it to those tools. And those tools can be residing somewhere else, not in the same location, right? We can do packet trimming and slicing. Some tools want to look at the payload. Some tools want to look at the frame header. We can also generate NetFlow, of course, because some tools want to look at the summary of the data or the metadata. It was very interesting. One of our customers was doing a POC, and they said, you know, we're going to test two systems. One system was ours. You don't want to decide which one to go with. And so they're sending identical traffic. And they called us and said that your packet broker is sending more traffic to the tools. The competitor is sending less. So they called us, we inspected, investigated, and what became clear is that the competitor, the orange box, was dropping packets left and right. What the customer was doing, it was turning on these compute-intensive processes. I want deduplication, I want SSL decryption, I want NetFlow. And the competitor, because it's so compute-intensive, was dropping packets. Yet, it was not telling that it was dropping packets. There were no counters. So if you did not do this POC, you would think, all right, I'm going to spend all that money investment, I'm going to buy my tools, I'm going to tap everywhere, get the data, aggregate it, filter it, and the last minute I'm going to drop it. What's the point? You would be comforted to think that it actually you have visibility, but you don't. Right? And that's one of the many, among many things that's special about us, is that we do not drop packets. In any data compute intensive process, we do not drop packets. But we always continue to go above and beyond. And we also provide application intelligence. So we're not just looking at packets, but on the graphical user interface, you can actually see the applications. We match signatures on that frame that's coming in, on the packet stream that's coming in, and exactly tell you what application that is. So you can decide, you can filter based on applications. Maybe you don't want to send your Netflix traffic to your tools. Maybe you want to send business intelligence information. Maybe you want to send WhatsApp-related information, or any among hundreds of thousands of applications, you can actually see it on the graphical user interface. You do not have to go box by box, try to enter regular expressions, or try to do bit matching on your devices using CLIs. Right? And this is a subscription-based system where every 2 weeks, the fabric will essentially download that, and you will get the latest and the greatest applications. And by the way, the signatures change even for the old applications all the time. So not only are you up to date, but you also get new applications incorporated into your system. No coding necessary, no programming necessary, right? It's as simple as that. And all of that under a single pane of glass management. This whole fabric. Of course, single pane of glass management is great, except that if it's not easy to use, then what's the point? What you're seeing here is a graphical user interface where I can see all my network ports on the left. We're gonna see it in the demo. And I can see all my tool ports on the right. And I can apply filters in the middle. And with simple drag and drop, I can just decide which ports should go to which tools, which data should go to which tools, and I apply intelligent filtering. There's also something to be said about being able to see topology, the whole network and security topology in one graphical user interface. Again, I can see my network ports. I can see that bypass switch that I had. I can see my tool ports. I can even see third-party tools on that graphical user interface. And that's very powerful. Because the more easy it is, the more we can get out of our platform. And as you get better, you get better insight, right? If it's something hard to use, we end up not being able to use it, and you don't use it. You don't get much information. And so we have invested in creating an incredible user experience. You can see the applications running in your network. I can see visitors coming from different countries, right? I can see which handheld device they're using, what operating system, what browser. I can filter based on that. So it's very powerful. I can see the countries. I can filter based on countries. If my business is not expecting any traffic from France, and I'm getting traffic from France, and it's increasing, something might be wrong. Maybe I'm under attack. Maybe there's a hack happening, right? That's very good insight that I can act upon. I can filter based on applications. Yesterday I was looking at this. I didn't even know that we can do it, you know, based on ask.fm, right? It's not just, you know, well-known popular applications. It's all these unknown applications too. Maybe it is important for your business, right? So you can filter it based on that. Not instead of entering, I'm going to just send layer 2 to layer 3 traffic and based on this IP address and start doing regular expression matching, I can actually have high-level intelligence. Of course, we support NetFlow because some tools want metadata. That's great. Again, this is one of those things that are compute-intensive. As the traffic goes up, it becomes more and more compute-intensive. Did I mention that we do not drop packets? It's very important. Interestingly, when the traffic is low, typically visibility is okay because you have good visibility because there's no traffic and tools perform well. It's really when you need the visibility and security when the traffic goes up, and this is when tools start to fail. And that's why it's important to never drop packets. Some customers have said NetFlow is great, but we need information above and beyond NetFlow. So we developed iXFlow. Some tool vendors have incorporated this technology into their tools, right? So they actually get value out of iXFlow and they deliver that to those customers. You might be thinking, well, okay, this is interesting. I did not know about visibility, but yes, it's a significant industry and there are other players in this marketplace. There are the usual suspects, such as Arista, Brocade, and Cisco, your usual Cisco switching companies, right? But as we mentioned, switching devices are very limited in terms of what they can do. The span ports is best effort. As soon as application data goes up, they start dropping packets. And the amount of filtering that you can do on regular switches is very limited, right? A switch is never meant to be something that you can fully control and send packets anywhere. Then there's companies such as Big Switch and NetScout that have dedicated appliances, and they do some advanced filtering capabilities based on layer 2, layer 3. But there's a Gigamon that goes into the context-aware data processing side, and they do, you know, definitely SSL decryption, NetFlow, some of that. But Ixia is unique in that it goes all the way up to the application layer, and regardless of where it operates, it never drops packets. And that's why it's essentially become the chosen vendor for customers as well as technology partners. What we're going to do, James and Guang are going to show many of these concepts in a demo using our flagship product, Vision One. Very excited about it. It's a one RU platform. Looks like a switch. It is not a switch. It's much more than that. And they're going to go step by step showing many of the concepts that I just talked about here. Now, if we have time, I also want to talk about some of the things that we're doing with Cisco integration, Cisco ACI integration. Using a single interface that I showed earlier, we can talk to Cisco switches, 3K and 9K switches, and turn them into network packet brokers. So they no longer act as a switch. They act as a network packet broker that we can control through a single user interface, and they become part of that visibility fabric. Customers are very excited about this. Now, this is the first phase of the Cisco integration. And this is really, we're using SDN concepts because we're using a combination of OpenFlow as well as Cisco APIs to talk to these devices. And the next phase will be adding integration with their ACI controller. So we can provide lifecycle management and visibility for their virtual as well as physical devices and applications. So as soon as a application comes up, we will learn where the application is from the controller, associate a virtual tab. As it moves, the virtual tab will move with it. And when the application is gone, we will delete that service. So it's complete lifecycle management and security. But again, that's the second phase. But what I'm really excited about is the really groundbreaking work that we're doing in terms of delivering visibility and security to Amazon. Chris is going to talk about that.